How are you? Happy Wednesday! If you're watching this before 11, remember we have morning meeting today. If I'm motivated on Wednesday, I'm out down by the beach. Got the palm trees, the ocean. My friend Marion Yusufo is waiting for me on my porch up at the house. I'm bringing in every other week people just to share their advice and their wisdom about self-empowerment, pursuing our career, how we can continue to pursue our career as artists and take care of ourselves. And again, that's all part of my Motivational Wednesday day. So let's get started with the moving and grooving, and then we'll go up to my house, meet Marion and her other friend who she brought with her. Connecting to our breath is what can really help us through really difficult times, the taking time just to breathe in and out, okay? So, we're gonna go meet my friend Marion. Thank you for the really, really wonderful words of wisdom to share with us. I'm really excited for you to meet her and hear what she had to say. So, let's go up to my porch, alright? Hi everyone, I am so happy to be here, and I have my friend Marion Yusufo here, and what's your daughter's name again?
Oh yes, Amina.
Amina. Alright, so guys, I have my friend Marion Yusufo here, and Amina, hi Amina! So Marion, if you could just give us a little brief audio description, and guys, we have a back on of like a back porch, porch overlooking the ocean and the flowers. It's really pretty. But Marion, if you could describe your beautiful self and Amina, that would be awesome.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me, Diana. I am a African woman of West African descent. I am about 5'8", 5'9". I have a head wrap, a very colorful African head wrap on, and a little green bow tie. And I'm carrying the baby who is 9 months, and she's wearing like a cute little checkered pink and white situation as well.
Oh, cool. All right. Thank you. Yay. Mary, you're so fun. Thank you for coming to my house.
Oh my goodness. Thank you for inviting me. Your house is gorgeous. Your house is peaceful. Your
Thank
house
you.
Is welcoming.
Thank you. Well, I cry. I love living out by the beach and having a little chat with you on my porch. So I am so, so happy that you're here. So, Marian, I want to know, how do you define yourself as an artist? How do you define yourself if you were to give, like, your 30-second pitch? How do you define yourself as an artist?
Wow, it's always shifting. But the place that I am in now, I can comfortably sit in and say, I'm a Mother Earth activist.
Mother Earth activist. I love that. So let me ask you, when was there a specific incident or point in young Marian's life, and it maybe where you're like, oh, this is, was it like immediate? Have you known since you were a child that art is what you wanted to do? So give me a little bit of your background, how you grew up, because I think you have such an interesting journey I'd love for you to share. And then, secondly, was there aha moment? Was it immediate or was it a more gradual realization for you?
Oh, the first one's definitely layered, but the second one is definitely easier for me to answer, which is it was not immediate. It was like a gradual stepping into my own type of situation. Mm-hmm. And then I'll piggyback to the first question, which is so layered. I like to say that I am grateful for having what I guess one would call in these modern times, hippie-like Nigerian intellectual parents,
mm-hmm.
who on their own account are brilliant people, and then allowed us children to be our own beings. Like, they really just let us be. And mm-hmm. I think that my privilege of saying that is always being number 5 out of 6 children. Mm-hmm. I don't know if my elder brothers would say so. We have, I think, or my mom's passed now, but what I would say is what I would always say when both my parents were alive is that I had kind of older parents. Mm-hmm. And so my brothers had them young and vivacious, and then I had them older, wiser, and freer, mm-hmm. In terms of my adolescence and growth. And so I kind of feel like I got the best of all of the worlds. And they just let me play, truly. Yeah. And I think one of those moments where I was like, oh, I think I'm an artist, very, very early, I always laugh at this experience, is when I was just a very chubby little munchkin baby, and we were all inside of the palau in Zaria, in Nigeria, mm-hmm. and we were listening to music, and my mom would tell my brother, stop the music. Because all they saw was my little chubby, I was just chubby, chubby one. Mm-hmm. I was rolling. I was like doing these rolls and when the music was on. And then my mom would stop the music and then she'd say, play the music. And then I'd continue rolling. They were like, this one's got something. And I think that they always kind of fed that. They didn't give me like, they didn't go, oh, let's put her in art. But they just fed my curiosity, mm-hmm. meaning if I was rolling, they continued to let me roll. Right. And a lot of times we would be at parties or we would throw parties and we would have on music like Shinopita or Fela Kuti, a bunch of Nigerian musicians. Mm-hmm. And I would just break it down on that dance floor as if that music was like my blood and water running through my veins. It wasn't anything, I don't, for me, still to this day, dance is not necessarily something that I see when I look at the DNA of dance and music as something necessarily sensual, even though one would look at my body and go, oh, she's moving sexy, right? I just look at it as something that makes sense to me. I listen to music and I move, and it just feels like a painting. It just feels like a symphony, you know, any kind of music. And that's how I fed and feed my comedy. It's the same way. It's kind of a, I think it's kind of a selfish way, because instead of looking to the audience to receive feedback, I kind of am just looking at the DNA of the stuff that's coming out of me and or the artist that I'm working with.
Right.
And the audience kind of comes second, even though I know that we pay homage and respect to our audience that take the time to watch. Mm-hmm. But nah, like that art is really for the artist first, is the way I see it. Yeah.
So, now you do a lot of comedy. It's so common, it's so sisters, and what motivates you to start things? Because I think as artists, some artists wait to be joiners, and we may wait for someone to invite us and they sign us. But you're a starter, and that's how I know you. It's because you started something that you invited me to be a part of, the Flat 90 sitcom and the Flat Magic School. So. And other things we're working on. So what motivates you to be a starter and then creating a table for other people to come and join you at? What motivates you to do that?
You know, I think it's something that probably all artists that are itching for something have. You know, it's like this idea of, we've read a lot of books or we've listened to a lot of music, and at a certain point I've learned that choreography, but if I'm still itching, or if my eyes are like, oh, I still don't see myself in that painting, or I don't see myself in this choreography, or I don't see myself in this play, though it be brilliant, though I'm enjoying using the words of these people, I don't see myself or my heartbeat. In that, and if I don't see myself, I gotta create that for myself. And so it's like oh, I gotta do it, and then when I do it, then naturally other people that either have a similar heartbeat like me or look like me or feel a void that they haven't seen yet in the mainstream, then come with me, and I'm all for that. I'm all for celebrating great stuff that exists. But I'm also cognitive of how we can miss a step in our artistic civilization if we don't treasure the stuff that hasn't been allowed to be put to the sunlight or put to the light. We miss a step, you know, and it's an unfortunate step. Like, I was talking to the one and only Sean Landry, who I believe is one of the pioneers of Black improv. And it was wild to recognize that sometime between age 35 and like 60, women, we just kind of disappear off of off of the media landscape. It's like, where we exist at zero, kid, hot 20-something, hot teen-something, and then all of a sudden we disappear, and then we're old women. And that is the existence of woman, whereas the hugest chunk of our lives is between 30 and 60, where growth is happening, where joy is happening, where pain is happening, and all these general human experiences that we love the heck out of when men share it about their own experience, yet we don't see it of our own woman experience. My gosh, what a tragedy for 50% of humankind. Or I should say 52%, because I think we're probably higher in population now.
I think, yeah, so speaking of improv, because I love improv and I know that is, we have so many artistic tools at our hand. What is it about the art of improvisation that, what draws you to that and to be a creator of improvisation? Because again, we met through Impro and Ally, so what is it about improv that draws you to it as an
Oh,
artist?
yeah. Improv to me is like it's like comedy gold. Improv to me is like family. Improv to me is like air and water and fire. Improv to me is life. And for me, what draws me to improv is that familiarity to home. Because at home is where I felt most safe. And where I could be myself. My family provided an environment, a petri dish, where I could replicate and just become all sorts of bacteria and no one judged me. And improv to me can be that in its healthiest form, when it's allowed to breathe and everyone is allowed to be themselves and folks are listening and ego is there, but like 3 feet away versus right on top of us, right? And so to me, improv is just a wonderful home like situation.
Cool. Right, so we're gonna go for my first word. I'm gonna pick a word and I want you to define how you incorporate that word for yourself as an artist and what does that mean to you as an artist. So the first word is, I got another magic face there.
Magic
Magic face! Believe. So, well, how do you incorporate the word "believe" for yourself as an artist? What, how is that word or tool, "believe"? What does that mean to you and your artistic, as you develop and work as an artist? The word "believe" or "belief." What does that mean to you when I say that?
Oh, you're asking an improviser. We're so layered. Okay, so belief. When I hear the word believe, I see my ancestors. I see great people that exist now that look like me. I also see the word bee, like flying bee that pollinates things and creates honey, right? And I see live, which is present time, which reminds me of life, breathing, balance, and present. And so I don't I just think believe is such a wonderful, simple, and it's just a powerful word at
Well,
the
and
same
I
time.
love it too because one thing that we are very passionate about at Performing Arts Studio West is that authentic representation of us as artists who have disabilities and making sure that our authentic representation and our multi-faceted representation, the intersectionality of our images as artists with disabilities is represented. So I love that you say that because that's so much about what we believe at the studio is that we see ourselves on the big and small screen. So I love that you say that. So yay, thank you. Oh, so what is who what who inspired you? What is the lesson? Because you talk a lot about your ancestors, and correct me, you were not born in the United States. You were, is that true? So what was that journey like? Because I love that journey to be born in another country and then coming to the United States, and what was that journey like, and what, I don't think it's there. What was that journey like? I know that's probably a 5-hour answer to a 2-minute question, but what was that journey? How old were you? What was that journey like for you, and how did that journey and what you learned impact how you live your life now?
Wow. I when I think of that 6-7-year-old girl, I'm just so grateful for her. She definitely just was a tough firecracker. And because of that firecracker, I am a firecracker, or at least I can sip on a little juice of that past to give me life, right? You started with who is my hero, and my heroes are my parents. And I mean, I just always kind of knock on wood and thank the Lord above for giving me the people that I was personally given. God, if a dark skinned 5'9" lady ever needed like dope women and men to be nurtured and reared by, God, I'm so glad that he gave me my parents, because I always look to their teachings, their compassion, their empathy, their gentleness, their love, their crassness, their power, all of the things that they showed without telling, right? They showed those things, and I watched and I experienced. And because of that, I can do the same. I do the same. And I'm just grateful for that. Now, coming to America, like I said, I was a 7-year-old firecracker. My father is a nuclear physicist it was through him that I was able to come here. And I flew on a plane with this Belgium stewardess and touch landed in Chicago and was an absolute little African warrior princess. I was like, what is this snow? And why do I need it? And where is all of my normal food that I eat? Because all of this is nonsense. And I had this very thick African accent, and I spoke like this, and I was not having any of this. And my God, I'm just so grateful for that energy, because America can swallow you whole. Can swallow your confidence, your who you are, because of the need to want to be a melting pot so much, it requires one to lose themselves. And so I lost my accent. I almost lost my language if it wasn't for the fact that the language is spoken at home, and we went to community pods of Yoruba speaking people. And so it's an interesting journey, and it's an active journey, because even to this day, now being a mother, I have to intentionally watch Yoruba things so I can intentionally speak Yoruba so my children hear the language of Yoruba. It's all so active and intentional. Sometimes I wish it could just be the norm, but it's give and take, you know? It's give and take.
So it sounds like those lessons, how do those lessons that young Miriam learned about resiliency, how are they supporting you in navigating the industry now, which can, again, be very challenging and very hard on us? So how do they support you as you navigate being an artist in the industry now?
Oh, that's such a great question. I think that It goes back to our whys. You know, when we're studying as actors and performers and our artistry, if you're a writer, director, there's always a why of why we started doing the thing that we do. And it's hopefully because you love it, or it's maybe because you want your voice to be heard. Whatever it is, I feel like leaning into that why so passionately and with such clarity that it allows for the heartache and the failure that will happen to I guess hurt less because like you should count on if you understand finance, right? It's like, okay, you should have a budget. You should budget for your car breaking down. You should budget for everything the car requires, your insurance, that yearly registration, etc., and more. I feel like it's the same thing as artists. And then if we are even in specific pockets, black, dark skinned, this, all of these extra pockets, it's like you should budget your energy and your training and your finances for all of these types of things that are gonna try and block your what it is that you're trying to get to. And so, I think that I always think that you should be a student forever, right? And you should be a student of law. You should be a student of money. So you have a good relationship with it, like a good and genuine relationship with it, right? Where you're not like, money is bad, money is evil. Well, we all is in this capitalistic environment are choosing to dabble in money. So we should understand that language. We don't have to be experts, but we should understand it. And it's the same thing with the industry. We should be knowledgeable about what it means to be a head of a studio, what it means to be a director, what it means to be a gaffer. What is it? Well, who is the person that puts the tape all around the square footage of where you're about to do your specific line? Because if you understand the basics of all of that, you then go back to the notion of what we all are as humans, which is we are mammals that are social animals that work in pods and community. And so in order for this art that we're doing called TV, film, theater to work well, we have to all commune well together. We all have to be respectful, and I know it's not always, my God, it doesn't happen all the time, but we all get to be respectful of each person's work, even if it's the person, the craft service person. Do you know the work that it took for that person to come and show up and be this person being delightful for you so that you can replenish yourself? Do you know the work that it takes of the person who drove you to the lot? You know, like all of these people, like a block, are working in community to allow all of us to then be our best selves as artists. You know?
Oh my God, that's so beautiful. That is so beautiful because for me, one of the things I love about this art is the sense of community you get to create. So, we're gonna do two more things. I'm
Do you
gonna
mind if
give it.
the baby just woke up? I'm gonna grab her, okay?
Oh, okay, go grab the baby. Go grab the
I
baby.
was in my crib crying.
Oh no, baby. Hello, sweetie. So anyway, we're going to go with I'm going to go with I'm gonna give you a word and I want you to kind of create a affirmation about this. Okay, so your word is success. So what would you like to say is like an affirmation about success?
Yeah. Oh, that's a good one.
That's a good one.
Ooh, that's hot. Okay, for me, I want to say, just like I'm learning to have a good relationship with money, I want to have a good relationship with success.
Okay, I love that. I love it. I want to have a good relationship with success. Cool. So, Marian.
Yes, what, lady.
Thank you so much for coming and hanging out. What is your favorite rock out song? Because we always move and groove at the end of my class. So what is your favorite rock out song?
Oh, you know I love anything Madonna.
All right. That makes me we can get Madonna. All right. How about Holiday? All right, guys, let's thank Marian and Simpo, her beautiful little daughter. Guys, thank you for hanging out with me today.
Hey, you're
welcome. And I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you, Marian. I love you. I can't wait to see you in person and give you a big hug.
Oh, same here, Diane. Thank you for having me.
All right, guys, see you tomorrow. Love ya. Words of wisdom from Marian Isifu. Just like I'm learning to have a good relationship with money, I want to have a good relationship with success. Marian is dressed in a yellow and shirt, gray jacket with a pink headband. Words appear in a heart. Believe in the power of you.